ladies and gentlemen, Pope Benedict the 16th.
Heil Hitler! I mean, bless you! Okay, listen up. We got a problem with the priest stooping the kids, and that's just plain wrong. But who am I to judge? Oh, yeah. I'm the fucking Pope, for Christ's sake. The Gartenführer. Where's my stupid staff? Where's my oh, here it is. And now I'd like to bring out our headliner. He comes to us all the way from Boys Town. Let's all hear it for Father Dennis Leary!
New York. Good. I am so glad to hear it. Welcome to Douchebag Night. Tonight we have some fun with all kinds of douchebags, all sizes and shapes. We started out singing about the Catholic Church, pretty much the center of all douchebaggery. The Catholic Church, that should be their motto, fucking your kids up the ass in 639 AD. We don't care what color they are, we'll abuse them sexually. Bring them on in. But they're not alone, the Catholic Church. Now, there are douchebags everywhere, including this guy. You know who this is? George Reker. Let me fill you in case you don't know who he is. George Reeker has been in the news lately because he is the head of an anti-gay right-wing Christian coalition group. Yeah. Don't get ahead of me. Look, I am trying to present his case here. Very, very objectively. Now, don't start laughing. You don't even know if it's funny yet. Stop it. George, stop it. George, wait. George recently had a hernia operation, okay? Now, he had also planned a trip to Europe to recover from that operation. Now, he obviously could not carry his own luggage with the hernia operation, so he had to hire somebody to go on the trip with him, because he's single, to carry the luggage for him. This is the man that George hired. Now, this advertisement is from a website called rentboy.com. In this particular bunch of information, this young man, who was hired by George to carry his bags, I think we all know which bag he was in charge of carrying, folks, let's be honest. No, put down the ones with the handles. Carry this one over here. What are you, crazy? In this chunk of information, the kid explains that he's good at massages and conversation and traveling, and that he also has, a very important fact, a smooth, sweet, tight ass. Which, of course, can be very important when carrying luggage. You don't want some simian-looking motherfucker carrying your luggage with his hair sticking out of his fucking jeans and everything. What, you got a chimpanzee to carry your bags there, George? Why don't you get a smooth, sweet, tight ass like I did? Now, George tried to sneak back into the country through the Miami airport, okay? Meanwhile, while he was out of the country, somebody was onto him and they photographed him. He rushed to his office and put out this statement on his website. This is George's website, ProfessorGeorge.com. And here's his statement. I am not gay and never have been. Now, haven't we reached the point with these right-wing anti-gay assholes that every time they say a statement that starts with I am not gay, what we hear and read is I blow guys, right? That's what we hear. As soon as they type it in, I typed in I'm not gay, but it comes out I blow guys. I am immediately resigning my membership in NARTH. What the fuck is NARTH? Do you know what NARTH is? I didn't know what NARTH is. You know what NARTH is, folks? It's this. The National Association for Research and Therapy of Homosexuality. George was not taking that kid over there just to have fun sex. He was doing research. He was doing scientific research. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that you might be a homo. I don't know. I'm not certain, a little bit longer, but I'm pretty sure. But I can fix you. After the trip, I'll fix you. These guys, I mean, remember Senator Larry Craig a year and a half ago? He was the senator from Minnesota who was caught in a Minneapolis men's room airport stall. He was in the airport men's room stall, and he was caught tapping the foot of an undercover state trooper who was in the next stall over. Think about that. He's in a men's room stall, and he's tapping the foot of somebody in the next stall over, okay? And so anyways, he comes out with a statement, and this is another great statement. I don't know if you remember this, but he actually came on television with his wife. Now, if you remember his wife, she looked like actually Mike Ditka if Mike Ditka was a lesbian, ladies and gentlemen. Do you remember? She was about 5'4 and about 360 pounds with short blonde hair. Go ahead, read the statement, honey. Make sure you mention I'm not a lesbo. Go ahead, mention that too. She's wearing like a sweater that she wove out of testicles. You know what I mean? She's like, go ahead, tell them I'm not gay. Go ahead, and tell them I'm not gay either. Fucking kill you, don't get to me. And Larry's statement was, I am not gay and never have been. Surprise. You gotta love this part of it. I have a wide stance when I defecate. First of all, it's never good when you have to use the word defecate when you're defending your sexuality on national television. And let's talk about the wide stance, folks. You know what? I've taken some pretty big shits in my life, I'll be honest with you. I've taken shits bigger than my own children a couple of times, you know what I mean? Especially in a men's room, airport men's room, because, you know, you might eat some Sparrow pizza. You know how good that shit is. Or maybe a couple of Whoppers. Next thing you know, you got to go in there and you got to let one go, right? Now, also, I'm a pretty long-legged motherfucker. I don't know if you noticed. Yeah, my hips are actually right here, ladies and gentlemen, okay? I'm like a size 38 length, okay? I'm a long-legged Irish skinny asshole. So I've got a pretty wide fucking stance. So let's use me as a measuring stick, okay? Now, you go into that men's room, and let's say, let's give him the benefit of the doubt. Let's say you go in there, you got to get a wide stance to begin with, right? Let's say it's the men's room bowl. Maybe you don't want your ass to touch the bowl because it's kind of dirty. You know how men's rooms are in general, but the ones at the airport really suck, right? So you're in there, you got the wide stance going, you got a big shit to take, and you don't want the ass to touch the ball. So you're pretty wide. Now look at my feet. How wide am I? I'll tell you how wide I am. As wide as every other straight man in this audience. Wide enough to shit, but my feet do not enter the airspace of the stall on either fucking side. That is a rule. Every guy in this audience knows when you go into an airport men's room stall, you actually check. Yeah, I've got 2 inches on that side and two on that side. He's not in my airspace, I'm not in his airspace. And as far as tapping the foot of the guy in the next stall goes, most guys wouldn't even ask the guy next door if you ran out of fucking toilet paper. You would rather sit there and go, you know what? I'm gonna have to air dry. That's what I'm gonna have to do. I am out of toilet paper in here. And I'll be damned if I'm gonna ask either guy on either side of me, because that would be considered kind of a homo move. I'm just gonna have to air dry this baby. That's what I'm gonna have to do here is just. I don't care if I miss my fucking flight or not. I'm staying in here till I'm air dry. You would actually end up using your own socks before you would ask a guy, I'm gonna have to de-shoe and take my socks off and wipe my ass with my socks. Actually, this is a pretty big shit. I might have to take my shirt off. I might have to be the bare-chested guy on the fucking airplane. That puts that theory to rest. Next in the douchebag parade is Miss USA, the current Miss USA. I love her. Look at her, she's beautiful. But we got douchebags all over this country who are up in arms. Oh my God, she's Arab American. We got a terrorist from Miss USA. What if she puts bombs in her crown and then comes to my town and visits my town and blows my fucking town up? This is how rampant and insane the racism has gotten in this country. First of all, look at her, she's gorgeous. This is when she won, okay? But you want proof that she's more American than she is Arab American? Here you go, ladies and gentlemen. Stripper contest held by a radio station. There she is. About 6 months before she became Miss USA. Only thing she's terrorizing is my cock, all right? One more picture, look at this one. Oh yeah, now that's Miss USA to me. I think that should be a contest as part of the Miss USA thing from now on. Every time they have the pageant, we should have a camel toe contest within it. I'm voting for number four. She's got the best camel toe. I really believe in her. I am sick of the racism running rampant, and one of the ways we get it now is the Mexicans, fucking Mexicans, man, coming over here taking our jobs. And everybody says it's not racist. Really? It's not racist? It's not based on the fact that they're brown-colored, no? Meanwhile, there's millions of Canadians coming over the border every day drinking beer and fucking beating the shit out of each other in skates. Nobody says a fucking word about them. No, we love them. They look like us. They're white. We are so lucky to have Mexico as a fucking neighbor. A country basically full of hardworking people who want to come here and marry each other and have families. And we're complaining about them? We could have a Taliban country down there. And it is based on racism. Let's be honest. If Sweden was where Mexico is, they'd have to put up a wall to keep us from going down there trying to grab 6-foot-tall blonde chicks and run them back home again. John McCain would be in his house going, honey, I got a new landscaper. Her name's Inga. What do you think? Next in the douchebag parade. Yeah, I mean, seriously. I mean, is there any fucking hope for this guy at this point? This is a 53-year-old man, and you could see the pain. One thing I love about this mugshot, this is the most recent mugshot. You could look in the eyes. You can really see he's like, damn, Parcells are going to kick my ass now. Shit. Fuck up. But it's a mugshot. He has what you're supposed to have in a mugshot. Remorse and shame, okay? So does she. Remorse, shame. Most of the shame here has to do with the fact that she didn't put her makeup on before she went out drunk driving, but still, there's remorse and there's shame, two things you're supposed to have in your mugshot, not like this fucking douchebag right here. Look at, this is the shot after he was arrested with a secret stash of Viagra and suitcases full of OxyContin that he was smuggling in from Mexico, a country that he fucking hates because they're all full, you know, they're all trying to get in here. And this is the picture he takes. Look at him, he's like, yeah, Rush Limbaugh, take my goddamn picture, yeah. I got a 15-foot-long erection right now, yeah. Here, let me get my cock in here. Hang on a second. Yeah, here we go. Take our picture. How do I look? Good, goddammit. No remorse, no shame. Neither does this guy have any remorse or shame. Now, I love Mel Gibson. I think he's a great director and a great actor. But let's just go over the basic facts of the story. 15 minutes before this picture was taken, supposedly, he went on a vicious anti-Jewish tirade that he said was the tequila talking. Folks, had some experience with the tequila. Oh yeah, went on a lot of fucking tirades in my life while I was on tequila. Anti-Derek Jeter, anti-Yankees, anti-my family, anti-my, you know what I mean? We've all gone a little bit fucking crazy. Never once went on an anti-Jew tirade, not me. Let's be honest, if this was the truth, if it was the tequila talking, wouldn't there be a no-Jew zone in Mexico starting around 4:45 every day, right before happy hour? All right, you Jews, you have to get off the beach at 5:00, all right? No, we don't mind you being here now, but once that people start drinking, you have to get out of here, because then they fucking hate you. Mel's coming down. Hurry up, get off the beach. So 15 minutes before this, he's trying to tell us he has no memory of what the fuck he was talking about. I don't really believe it because his hair's too perfect. It's like the cop said, Mel, we're about to take the mugshot now anyway. Let me comb my hair. How's that? Nah, I don't believe it. You want to see a picture of two guys who I think probably don't remember what they were saying about 15 minutes ago? Here you go. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. These are the two most valuable trading cards in the fucked up Hall of Fame, ladies and gentlemen. If they had a fucked up Hall of Fame and they were gonna put statues out in front, these would be the two statues that you would see. These guys are not fucking around. They went fucking deep on these particular nights. Two of my favorite celebrities of all time, Nick Nolte, I like to say Nolte, I like to pronounce a little accent on the last one, terrific actor, and of course, the godfather of soul, James Brown. Now, I don't know if you remember this particular arrest of James Brown. This is 1989. This is a fantastic one. James Brown is smoking PCP all day. Remember PCP? Angel dust. They had to get rid of it. They turned crack. They got PCP and they turned it into crack because it was a little bit easier to handle. PCP, angel dust, was a horse tranquilizer. You had hallucinations while you were smoking it. You could actually believe you were a fucking horse while you were doing PCP. You'd be walking around all fours in your house going, what are you sitting on the rug for? I'm a horse. I'm the godfather of horses. Come on, get them all back now. Come on, ride me now. I feel good. Smoked PCP all day, got in his pickup truck with a shotgun. The police chased him for 6 hours from South Carolina into Georgia. In Georgia, they shot out all four tires. On the rims, he drove all the way back into South Carolina. This is a celebrity fucking arrest, ladies and gentlemen. This is no Perez Hilton fucking bullshit. This is the real deal. On PCP, and by the way, when they arrested him, they got him out of the truck, you know, they found 7 grams of PCP still in one of his pockets. You know what his excuse was? I had some dental implant surgery. How many of you, when you go to the dentist, that's what you say? You know, forget the gas. Just give me the PCP. I'm going PCP. I want to actually believe I'm a crocodile while I'm in the chair and you're working on my teeth. Is that possible? Do you know how hard it is to drive a pickup truck at 120 miles an hour with no tires while you're shooting at the police with a shotgun and you think you're a horse? It's pretty fucking hard, I'm pretty sure. Not certain, but I think it's pretty hard. You're probably tempted to pull over and eat some grass, you know what I mean? It's crazy. You get out and they ask you, how fast do you think you were going? Meanwhile, he did it all with this crazy fucking Indian blanket on. I swear to God, if you go on the internet, on the arrest report, the cops described this as an Indian blanket. He was driving around for 6 hours with a fucking Indian blanket on. That Indians probably gave it to him. Yeah, chief races with pickup. We love him. Honorary chief. Fuck dances with wolves. We want races with pickup. But at least to his credit, if you take a good look at him, he knows he's getting his mugshot taken. I mean, he looks like he's still talking, like he hasn't shut up the whole time. Taking the picture now, James. Oh, man, my mama, Godfather's over. I feel good. Can't do no more. I need some oats. Kevin Costner, motherfucker. But he knows he's getting his mugshot taken. Nick Nolte? Not so much. He's not even really framed the right way. He's like still moving. It's like he thinks he's on the set of one of his movies or some shit. You know what I mean? He's walking around like, all right, I'm ready to shoot now. Where's Barbara Streisand? Let's go. Let's get this fucking thing going. Prince of Tides, that's me. Let's go. Let's roll it up now. My guy's just like cops. What is this, 48 hours, part six? What's going on? Where's Eddie at? What's going on? Come on, I'm ready. Hey. Am I Nick Nolte or Gary Busey? What's going on? Who am I? Nick, we're gonna take the mugshot now. You wanna fix your hair? What hair? This ain't my hair. These are ideas coming out of my hair. These are thought strands that are coming out of my But as fucked up as these two guys are, here is the all-time greatest mugshot, celebrity-wise, in my opinion. Amy Winehouse, ladies and gentlemen. She's so fucked up, she's out of focus, all right? That's not the camera, that's her. They tried three different cameras to get her in focus down there. Sir, she's still out of focus. I don't know what the fuck's going on. Why am I under arrest? Because you're out of focus. It's a new law. You have to be in focus to walk around amongst the other people. And she's got like burn marks up on her forehead, and she's got one burn mark in her eye socket. Like she was using herself as her own ashtray or something. You know what I mean? I put this on. And this was in a London pub this night when she was busted. And you know, as fucked up as she was that night, there was at least one guy in that bar who wanted to have sex with her. There had to be. Some guy was going, oh, I'm gonna fuck Amy Winehouse now. Bob, she's blurry. I don't care. She's famous. I don't care if my penis comes out of there blurry. I'm going in. And the last celebrity mugshot, take a look at this one. You know, every time I show that picture, I get the same response. You all did the, And I don't understand why. I think it's because we all still love Elvis. And so when I show this, yeah, right? I show this, you feel bad that Elvis got arrested. I got news for you. Elvis was never fucking arrested. Elvis did this himself. Elvis was so fucking high, one night, he called up the fucking police and said, hey, Elvis, I'm coming down. I want to get my picture taken and my mugshot. I never had it done. Rip, get the boys. I want to get down and get my mugshot taken. He got all dressed up. He's got his TCB, taking care of business glasses. He's got the medallions and the high collar and everything. He looks pretty fucking good. He's a little, you can see a little, he's a little fucked up. You know why? Elvis didn't drink. You know that, right? He didn't drink alcohol. You know what he drank? Formula 44D. I love him. It makes me love him more. Formula 44D. When he wanted to get really high, he'd drink like four bottles. Think about that. She's doing shots of cough medicine.
That's right. Guy never had a fucking cold as long as I worked for him.
Elvis invented the addiction to prescription medicine that's going on in this country. Think about it. End of his life, fat, bloated,
addicted to thousands and thousands of different pills. Really fucked up, right? That's what we're all turning into. Big, fat, gassy, bloated fucking people. Addicted to prescription drugs. It's out of control. Now listen, I'm just like you. When I get sick, I want to take medicine. You know what I take? NyQuil for everything. I don't care if it's a cold or a cough or cancer. I take NyQuil. I love NyQuil. I've been singing its praises for 20 fucking years. You know why? You pop the shot glass off and drink it straight out of the bottle. Medical moonshine, ladies and gentlemen. 3 minutes later, you're fast to fucking sleep.
I had prostate cancer last night, and now it's gone. New cancer quill. I love it.
And I love the warning. The main warning on the side effect on the side of the bottle of NyQuil may cause drowsiness. That's not a side effect. That's a fucking promise, ladies and gentlemen. That is a goddamn good product. It does exactly what it says it's going to do. Most of the people I know that take prescription drugs never even think about the side effects. They don't even read the little packaging on the side. They just want to take it and feel better. Well, tonight I'm going to point out some of the side effects that you should really be paying attention to. Number one, little drug called Allie. It treats weight loss. It's a weight loss aid, okay? Let's take a look at the side effects. Number one, oily spotting in your undergarments. Where I come from, we call that shitting in your pants, ladies and gentlemen. If I went to my mother when I was a kid and said, I think I got some oily spotting in my undergarments, you shit your pants again, didn't you, son of a bitch? Oily or fatty stools. What the fuck is a fatty stool? I mean, what are you, shitting midgets at this point?
Little midget comes out, Jesus Christ, I'm glad to be out of your ass, I'll tell you that much. Holy shit, I was stuck up there for a long time.
The reason they created the statement, oily spotting in your undergarments, is because they don't want to use anal leakage anymore. Allie was the drug that basically invented anal leakage. I still like anal leakage. I think it's better. Sounds like a heavy metal band from the 80s, doesn't it?
I saw anal leakage, man. Fucking excellent. I saw him with nausea and black stool, man. It was excellent.
Anal fucking leakage. Yeah, you're losing weight. It's coming right out of your ass. Next, Cymbalta treats depression. Take a look at the side effects. I love this one. Number one, hallucinations. Number two, suicidal thoughts and attempts. Isn't this why you're taking the drug in the first place? I'm so depressed. I'm so depressed. I need to take something that's gonna make me feel better. Red, blistered, and peeling skin. Oh, I'm so happy. I'm so happy. My skin is peeling off. You could light a cigarette off my ball sack, but I'm so happy. Vomit that looks like coffee grounds. Think about this. Vomit that looks like coffee grounds. Blah. Bob, you want a cup of coffee? Let me see if I can puke up some cream and sugar for you. Hang on. Vomit that looks like coffee grounds. Next, Viagra. Yes, where all the guys go,
I don't know anything about this one. I hope this is funny. I don't know anything about this, honey. Holy shit. Can't wait to see what Dennis has to say about this. I've always wondered what this drug is about. I'm going to find out now.
Now imagine you're a guy taking it for the first time. You open up. Here's the new symptom list in the order that they're listed. Number one, headache.
I don't care about that. Temporary blindness. Well, my wife's not that good looking anymore anyways. Well, that's probably a good thing. I don't mind being Ray Charles for a half an hour or so. Heart attack, bullshit. Chest pain, who gives a fuck about that? Death, wait a minute, death, what? Wait, whoa, wait, what? Death? Wait a minute, what the fuck?
All right, let me go back. Temporary blindness, I'm a heart attack, just death. I don't know about that. Loss of hearing, she does talk a fuck of a lot. I know that much. I don't know about this death thing. Hang on. Oh, wait a minute. 4-hour erection. No, I'm in. I don't care. I'll take the chance. Their sales have gone up 25% since death began to be listed as a side effect. Think what that says about the male libido.
Well, I might die, but I would die with a 4-hour erection.
Maybe I'll even beat myself to death with my own cock. That'd be kind of fun. The most famous one of these side effects with Viagra and all these penis drugs, they all say, call your doctor if you experience a 4-hour erection. Does anybody know any fucking guy that called this doctor after experiencing a 4-hour erection? Except to say, doc, hey, yeah, I got one. You can get more of this shit, right? Okay, I'll call you back. You call all your friends if you get a 4-hour erection. Guys, bring a camera over. I got a 5-hour erection going right now. And bring those horseshoes. I got an idea for a new game. Hurry up. Let's go down the batting cages. Hey, film this. Watch this. I'm a switch cocker. Watch this. Film me a curve. Fucking men. We suck. It's like they have that one now that they call the Weekender. You get a hard-on that will basically last all weekend. You guys love this one, right? They don't even care if their wives are home. Just walking around the neighborhood, 46 hours, look at this baby. 46 and a fucking rump. Yeah, I know, I put that Louisville Slugger thing on there myself. It's my idea. Next, Requip. Now this treats restless leg syndrome. I'm not really sure what that is. What I imagine is this thing, right? When your leg won't stop shaking, right? That's gotta be it, right? Your leg won't stop shaking. It happens to all of us if you have too much coffee or maybe you're a little nervous, right? We're all kind of familiar with this thing, right? Look at this fucking side effect. May cause uncontrollable urge to gimp. You think the Indians who run the casinos had any idea of helping out with this drug when they were in development? We need something that'll make them gamble their asses off. We don't care if they have anal leakage. We'll build toilets into the fucking seats at the blackjack table. We just need them gambling. Unfucking believable. Restless leg syndrome. This is on the tip of what I like to call the situations that are developing in America where we are inventing diseases now. Mm-hmm. Restless leg syndrome. I'll let it go. I'll let it go. I'm not gonna get angry about restless leg syndrome. But this one, seasonal affective disorder. It's a true thing. Sad, I have it. It's not funny. I have sad. I do. Every fall when the leaves fall off the trees. When it gets cold outside, I get very depressed. It's called winter numbness, all right? We all fucking experience. Drinking a couple of beers, put on some gloves, go out and shovel the fucking snow, all right? It's not a disease. It's a fucking season. That's what it is. You want SAD? I'll give you SAD. Shovel in the face disorder. How about that? What the fuck? What, the rest of us are doing Irish jigs when it's 27 inches of snow falling on the ground. What the fuck? Seasonal affective disorder. They have one for the fat people too now. It's called PAD. Have you seen the ads on TV? Peripheral artery disease. Yeah, I have PAD. I have PAD. I can't feel my feet. When I was a kid, they called it fucking gout, all right? It means you're too fat. Stop eating. You're the size of the moon. Fucking PAD. Nobody's fat, right? I'm physically challenged. I'm physically challenged. I'm not fat. By what? A fucking sandwich? What are you challenged by? I have low self-esteem. That's what I have. I have low self-esteem. I'm so tired of hearing about low self-esteem. This bullshit is driving me crazy. They didn't have low self-esteem when I was a kid.
You know, my kids are both in college now. When they were growing up, you know about this? Everybody gets a trophy? Oh, I fucking hated this. Everybody gets a trophy. Yeah, that's the new thing. You know, worried about their self-esteem and their feelings, so everybody gets a trophy. You suck. Here's a trophy. You really suck. Here's a bigger trophy. You suck and you're fat. Here's a trophy made out of chocolate. You can eat it. We don't want to hurt your feelings. When I was a kid, you know how you got a trophy? By winning the championship fucking game. That's how you got a trophy. Well, there was two ways. You win the championship game or you beat the shit out of the kid who won the championship game when he was on his way home. They both lead to high self-esteem. I have low self-esteem. I have low self-esteem. I have low self-esteem. Bipolar, that's the other one. I'm bipolar. Sometimes I'm really happy and sometimes I'm really sad. It's called Tuesday at my fucking house, all right? You're bipolar? My mother was fucking tripolar, all right? She could smack one kid in the head with a frying pan, call another kid a retard, and kick the third kid in the ass, all in a second and a half, all right? No fucking pills. Low self-esteem. Bye, fucking polar. Fuck you. We've created a generation of 35-year-old douchebags who all got fucking trophies for everything when they were growing up, and now they think the world owes them a fucking living. Yeah. I'm 35. I'm 35. Why am I not a rock star? I'm 35. Why am I not an outfielder for the Yankees? I'm 35. Fucking douchebags. I love them, though, because you can spot them. They've got all these new fashions. You can spot them from a mile away. Yeah. You seen the 35-year-old douchebags wearing the fucking wool hats in the middle of the summer? There was a guy out in front of the theater last night after the show, 110 degrees out, he's wearing the fucking baggy wool cap. You know why? Because he saw Brad Pitt or Colin Farrell in some fucking fashion magazine wearing it, and he thinks it's cool. He's walking around, yeah, I look fucking cool. Really? You're sweating harder than Lindsay Lohan in a liquor store, asshole. Take the fucking hat off! It's fucking July! And they've got these pants, the hip-hop shorts. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah, they're not shorts. They're not pants. They're shants. Yeah, shorts come to about your knee, right? Pants come all the way down to your ankles. You know the fucking shorts I'm talking about? They come to here. Yeah, they're shants. They're cool with my fucking wool hat. Don't I look cool? And all the douchebags who wear the hip-hop shorts, they all got the calf tattoo, right? You seen the calf tattoos? What a bunch of fucking assholes these kids are. They're all covered in fucking tattoos. Oh, aren't you fucking cool? You got a tattoo, a Chinese symbol on your calf, which you think means infinity, but actually in Chinese means kill me first when you invade America. I'm a 35-year-old douchebag with too much time and too much fucking money. Fucking assholes. And their shoulder bags. It looks like a purse. It's not, it's a shoulder bag. Looks like a purse to me. It's a carry-all. I think it's a purse. No, it's not. It's a satchel. It's a satchel. It's a fag fucking bag where I come from. Capital F, small egg. It's European. Well, then go to Europe and suck a fucking cock, all right? Lick a Spanish fucking dick in Europe with your fucking carry-all. Real men carry gym bags or shoulder bags with fucking sports logos on them. And we don't get manscaped. I get manscaped. I know my girlfriend loves it when I shave my testicles. No, she does. She loves it when I shave my balls. That's because she wishes you had a fucking vagina. That's why. They all want to be on reality shows. They all want to be big, giant TV stars. They have no fucking talent. They have no ability, but they want to be on TV, right? They've all got my dream is to do this and be famous. I want to be a famous person. That's my dream. You know, this is the land of dreams. It really is. You can pretty much do anything in America. But at a certain point, 35, 37, if your dream hasn't come true, time to cut it off at the fucking kneecaps. Time for a new dream. And the parents are really the people that are responsible. How about this 16-year-old girl tried to sail around the world? tries to sail around the world, fails. The mast breaks off the ship in the middle of the fucking ocean. She calls her dad for help. They spend $1.5 million to send out helicopters and planes to rescue her. Okay, hypothetical. I'm 16. I take a boat. I try to sail across the Atlantic Ocean. I have a cell phone, and I call my dad. Dad, my dream is turning into a nightmare. Can you come and save me? You know what my dad would have done? He would have rented a boat, driven all the way out, punched me in the fucking face, turned around and gone home by himself.
He'd get home, my mom would be like, where's Dennis? He sleeps with the fishes, honey. And we got a new fucking TV room, I'll tell you that much right now.
My dad was no bullshit, man. Fucking tattoos and piercings. If I came home, my dad with some piece of pierced metal in my face. Dad, look. Look what I got pierced into my face. Yeah, it looks good. Let me give you a couple more. Here, watch. Stay still. Staple gun. Go mow the fucking lawn, Man of Steel. Go ahead. By the way, there's douchebags everywhere. It's not just the 35-year-olds. There's plenty of douchebags in my generation, too. Yeah. And I'm going to just point a few of you out. I got a new rule. It's called you better be in a band rule. Yeah, this is it. If you're 50 years old and you got receding gray hairline, but you've grown that fucking hair into a big giant ponytail that goes all the way down to your ass, you better be the bass player for Brian fucking Adams. I'm telling you right now. Because if I see you and you're not the bass player for Brian Adams, I'm fucking cutting that ponytail right off. Cut the shit. What are you trying to do? Grow it back down to your ass, up through your ass, and back out of your ears? What the fuck's going on? Cut the fucking hair. If you're 52 years old and you got a giant gold hoop earring in one ear, you better be a fucking pirate. You better be a fucking pirate or Johnny Depp's fucking stunt double. I'm just telling you right now. And if you're 52 years old and you're a man and you're on Facebook, do us all a favor. Log the fuck off. Now. Log off the planet. And I mentioned Brad Pitt. You know, I make fun of Brad Pitt because of the wool hat. I actually have some sympathy for the guy. You know, I really do. I mean, he's had 8 kids from 9 different countries now. Is that what they're up to? Think about this poor fucking guy. One of the biggest movie stars in history. He's got to learn to say, shut the fuck up and go to bed in 6 different languages. Every night he's like, you, go to bed. You, vamanos. You. Ow, fuck, that hurts. Oh, that really fucking hurts. Wow, man. Jeez, just speaking comedy Chinese really fucking uses muscles that you never thought you had in your fucking head, you know what I mean? Mind down. I could be a Chinese singer and play my own bass. I'll be the Chinese thing. Ow, fuck. Oh, my whole fucking upper body's cramping now from the Chinese. Whole new respect for the Chinese people. Oh, wow. How did I get to the Chinese thing? Brad Pitt. Oh, I started the whole douchebag thing with Brad Pitt. No, I was just checking my brain. Sometimes I get into these bits and I look up and there's like 2,000 people looking at me and I'm like, fuck, I thought I was in my house. Shit. What am I doing? I'm doing a Chinese guy playing his neck tendons. I was talking about the fat people and then the douchebags, Brad Pitt,
I got it. I traced it back. No, I'm just, it's all on tape. I would have found that anyways. I just like to make sure I'm not fucking crazy. Wow. That was a little scary. That was a little, but we're okay. We're okay. I'm the host. Don't worry. I have everything under control. We're at Town Hall, and we're taping a special for Comedy Central. Yes. What if I introduced everybody in Chinese? We just came off a national tour warming up for this, and we're turning it into a special for Comedy Central that partially benefits my foundation. Which was great. We went across the country and raised money for the foundation. And we were really lucky to have with us a young lady who I first saw her at a comedy benefit we did last fall in Boston, the Comics Come Home, which we do every year up there for the Cam Neely Foundation. And she was working on the Chelsea Handler show. How she was brought to our attention. And she came up there and she killed, like 8,000 people. She rocked the joint. And then her career's been taken off since then. She came on tour with us. She's fantastic. She has her own Comedy Central hour-long special coming out later in the year and her own series on Comedy Central. She's fabulously talented. Please welcome Whitney Cummings, ladies and gentlemen.
Are we having fun or what? Yeah? This is cool, man. I love being in New York. I love being in New York because all my single friends are in New York, because all my friends now are getting married, so I have to go to all these events and shit. Like, I had a friend recently, she had a bridal shower. Nobody told me when you go to a bridal shower, you have to bring sex toys. I showed up with a teapot like an asshole. Sex toys have gotten crazy. There was one, it was a vibrator that had feathers on the end of it. I was like, is that in case you haven't had sex in so long, you can just dust it off? And then I had to go to a bachelorette party. Bachelorette parties are actually kind of fun, you know, because like all the male strippers are always in like policemen's uniforms and like firemen's uniforms. Because they say that women like a man in uniform. It's not that we like the uniform, okay? We like men with jobs. You will never see a male stripper come out with pajama pants on, holding a video game controller and a Pop-Tart. I used to be very against marriage. I used to be against it, but now I'm kind of into the idea, not because I believe in, like, happily ever after. I just want to get married so I can throw in the fucking towel. I want to get married so I can just stop going to the gym. The day after I get married, I'm never going to fucking shave my legs again, that's for sure. Just going to have fucking cornrows all down my legs. My vagina's gonna look like a porcupine. I don't give a shit. I'm gonna be done. I'm just gonna fucking eat funnel cake all day. All day, just wear a Slanket wherever I go. Not even a fucking Snuggie, a Slanket, the generic kind. That's how little I give a shit. It's gonna grow a dick. I don't care. I'm done. Women have motives. For everything we do, we have motives. Same thing with sex. We don't have sex with you guys just because we want your dick so bad. No. Half the time I have sex with a guy, it's because it burns calories, okay? I'm using my head. I'm like, oh, God, I had that gyro today. Didn't go to the gym. I guess I should just fuck this guy. I don't know. And the weird part is I actually wear headphones and ankle weights, and it actually works out perfect. You guys aren't like that. You want sex all the time, anytime. You guys are so obsessed with sex. I have guy friends where when they go get massages, they expect the masseuse to jerk them off. That's how insane you guys are. He's like, oh, yeah, I got a massage. She didn't even give me a hand job. What? No woman has ever expected that. No woman has ever been getting a massage and been like, oh, God, I really hope at the end of this, this guy fists me. I really hope this stranger puts his fingers inside my vagina. No, it's always the opposite. Anytime I've ever gotten a massage, I've been like, oh my God, his hand is really close to my vagina. You guys are so obsessed with sex. You want to think about sex while you're eating. You go to a restaurant called Hooters, where the waitresses are dressed in these ridiculous outfits. What are you doing? You're sitting there eating your chicken like, oh, yeah, look at that. Look at that butthole. Yeah, I really want to. That is disgusting. There would never be a restaurant for women like that called, you know, like, Dongs or something. Where all of the waiters are in Speedos, because that would be a disgusting restaurant. No one would ever fucking eat there, ever. You're sitting there eating your salad, some waiter comes at you with his fucking mushroom penis out. I don't want to see that, okay? That little shiitake mushroom, I don't need that. Flaccid penises in a Speedo is not cute, all right? It's not sexy. It looks like a hamster stuck in a water balloon. I don't want to see that. And it's always angled like a snorkel, like coming up or something. If there was going to be a restaurant where the waiters sexually aroused the women eating there, they would not be in Speedos. They would be in suits carrying briefcases, holding up their perfect credit reports, okay? Women are not like that. Women are more emotional. We are jacked up with so many more emotions than you guys are. I was reading a book on women's brains. We've got so many more hormones. We've got so many more emotions. I was reading that when women meet somebody new, we process them on literally thousands of levels, right? We meet someone, is she prettier than me? Is she smarter than me? Is she thinner than me? Da-da-da-da-da. When you guys meet someone, you process them on two levels. Am I going to fuck this person or not? No? Goodbye. That's it. Women, we are very emotional, but you guys hate it, right? You guys hate that we're so emotional. You guys are like, women are crazy. Women are crazy bitches. You think we fucking like being this way? You think this is enjoyable for me? You think it's a fucking picnic in there? You think this is fun for me? You think that's a walk in the park? You think I enjoy crying every time Celine Dion comes on the radio? You think it's fun for me to Google your ex-girlfriend 3 hours a day? Huh? You think I have time for that shit? Huh? You think I enjoy going through your cell phone while you're asleep every single night? I have carpal tunnel syndrome. I'm exhausted. You guys are like, just please don't stab me. Please don't stab me. Please. I don't know, man. So funny. We are pretty fucking crazy. But it's funny, you guys love sex. You guys love sex. And I think I figured it out. The reason you guys think about sex all the time is because women are gorgeous. When you guys see women, of course you want to have sex with them because all women are beautiful. We're not as obsessed with sex because you guys are fucking disgusting. I'm sorry. You're hideous. Your penises, how dare you with those things? They're embarrassing. You're just walking around with those things. All of you, oh, you must, Well, here's what I recently realized. I just got out of a 4-year relationship. And when you're in a long relationship, you get used to the penis that you see every day. It grows on you, right? But now I'm back in the game again. I'm seeing these new penises. Penises are like fucking snowflakes, okay? No two are the same. You see a new one and you're like, I've never seen that vein before. That's a new brown splotch I've never seen. I'm gonna have to go Google that later. I hope that shit's on WebMD. What am I supposed to do with that? But the problem, you gotta inspect the new penis. You gotta make sure everything's set. But the problem is, when you're that close to the penis, you're that close to the penis, okay? Which means you gotta do something about it. Which means you gotta put that thing in your mouth. That's what needs to happen. You have to somehow figure out a way to get that penis into your mouth. It never fucking gets easier, guys. Let me tell you that much. It never just gets easy to put a penis in your mouth. You gotta play all these mind tricks to get it in there. You gotta just fucking man up. It's like being on Fear Factor. You just gotta. No, I don't do that anymore. I have a bad back. I can't with that. You guys' penises are so ugly. The second you guys are born, someone has to cut some of it off just to make it even somewhat presentable. The doctor was like, I don't know, just cut it off. I don't know. I have seen an uncircumcised penis. Horrible. Horrible. Well, I didn't know what was going on because I saw it and I was like, it can't possibly. That hasn't happened since the Civil War, right? So I was like, I talked myself out. I saw it. I was like, what is that? A scrunchie on there? What is that? I don't know. Is that a tiny hoodie? What is that? Is Baby Gap making hoodies now? I do not like porn. Let me tell you why I don't like porn, because it raises the bar too high. You know what I mean? Like, women in porn are always like yelling so loud, which I guess you guys think that's sexy. I'm not like that at all. I'm very quiet in the bedroom. I like to keep a very low profile in there. I will occasionally whisper encouraging things. You know, I'll be like, good job. I really appreciate that. I really think you're showing a lot of improvement. Rudy, Rudy, Rudy. I don't like porn, but women, you should watch porn more. Watch porn just to see where your man is getting all those stupid fucking ideas. Literally, every time I watch porn, I'm like, oh, that's why he made me buy roller skates and a snorkel. Okay. That's why there's 2 pounds of pudding in the fucking fridge. So stupid. I love that you guys don't think we know you watch it. And we also know, because here's the thing, is that if you watch it on the computer, you'll either, number one, erase your fucking history in the menu bar, so I can't go to any of my websites, and I know you did some crazy shit. Or you don't erase your history, and I try to go to google.com, and it goes to goodasianpussy.com. I used to worry about porn. I used to be like, oh my God, my man is watching porn. He doesn't love me, or like, he's not attracted to me. Porn is not a threat to our relationships. I like to think about it like this. Guys watching porn is like women watching the Food Network. Okay, we're both watching shit we are never gonna fucking do. I don't know. Romantic comedies, that's women's version of porn, right? We watch romantic comedies. We compare you guys to the men in romantic comedies just like you compare us to the women in porn, right? You guys take us out to a 5-star restaurant, but in our minds, we're just like, yeah, well, Matthew McConaughey took his girlfriend into a hot air balloon and got her a diamond necklace and a pan. This is fucking bullshit. We want you guys to act like the men in romantic comedies, right? Which is so weird, because if you guys were actually to do anything that the men in romantic comedies do, it would totally backfire, right? Like, I feel like guys in romantic comedies always light candles. Women, we're like obsessed with candles, right? We're like pyromaniacs, right? You guys come over, we have candles everywhere. You don't know if we're gonna have sex with you or sacrifice you, right? But guys, you cannot light candles. If I go to a guy's house and he has candles everywhere, I don't think you're romantic. I think you took a dump, okay? We know what you're doing. Stop trying to glade your way out of that Chipotle or whatever. Romantic comedies, they brainwash women. I think we get brainwashed into being obsessed with romance. I think it starts with the nicknames we get growing up, actually. My dad, growing up, he called me Princess, right? Princess, he drilled into my head as a kid that I'm a freaking princess. And then I grew up and I got into the real world and I realized that no one else was on board with the whole princess thing, right? Princesses don't lose their virginity at Lollapalooza. That's just not... I think we need to start calling kids things to prepare them for real life. You know, get in the car, rehab, let's go. Women get called things that make them obsessed with romance. Guys get called things that make them obsessed with sports, right? You guys get called like champ, sport. You guys are so obsessed with sports. You guys can't even refer to increments of a relationship without referring to sports, right? First base. We got to second base. You don't see women running around referring to increments of our relationships through shit we like. It's not like last night, me and Mark. Chanel purse. You guys are so obsessed with sports, you guys will wear jerseys for teams that you're not even fucking on. But you think you're on the team, you'll be like, yeah, last night, I guess we just didn't score enough. We? The fucking Knicks don't need you. That's like me watching Grey's Anatomy in scrubs. You guys, I'm Whitney Cummings. Dennis Leary, everybody, come on!
Whitney Cummings, come on! Whitney Cummings. With a lot of true shit about men and our balls. We love our balls. I love my balls. I check them. I'm not even checking them for cancer. I'm just checking them. It just dawned on me the other day. I was doing it, and it wasn't even in the shower. It was like sitting watching TV.
And I, next thing I realized I had my hands down there. I wasn't checking for cancer. I was just feeling. I'm like, got two, still got two. 53. You guys watch Rescue Me? Look at this next guy. I've known him for, I can't even, it's been 3 decades or something. And he's crazy. If you watch Rescue Me, you know him as Uncle Teddy. Please welcome Lenny fucking Clark.
This is exciting. My God, you ever get up in the morning, look at yourself nude in the mirror and just say, fuck the diet, how fat could I possibly get? I did that for like 10 years and I blew up, and Dennis Leary saved my life. He did, not just my career, but my life. One day we're on the set of Rescue Me, it was the first season, and I was 388 pounds with a 56-inch waist. Yeah, that's huge. And he said to me, Lenny, I'm worried about you. I said, really? He says, yeah, I think you're too fat and I think you're gonna die. And I said, Dennis, this is a different side of you. I've never seen it. You really mean that? And he goes, no, I wrote a lot of good shit for you next season. And if you die, I'm going to have to get some other fat random guy. And it'll be like replacing Darren on Bewitched. People will be pissed off for a while, but they'll understand. And I said, you son of a bitch, this hurt me. I was upset. Because no one wants to be fat. And I lost 174 pounds, and people come up to me and go, did you want to lose the weight? Oh, thank you. You're so sweet. That is so nice of you. But if you all don't clap, it seems foolish. Look, here's what happens. No, I'm not fishing for compliments. I let myself turn into a big, fat, bloated piece of shit. It was no one else's fault but my own. But I had no idea it was going to get this bad. I mean, I'm lying there one day on the couch eating crab like an otter on my belly, you know. And all I was wearing was boxer shorts, and I was using them for a napkin. So, now I know that's a visual you could have went a lifetime without seeing. But I'm trying to open up more and be honest. It's what my probation officer has recommended ever since that terrible lobster tank incident. But the point is, here I am on the couch, and my wife comes in and says, do I look fat? And I looked up, I said, look at me, I'm a fucking otter. As long as you're married to me, you'll never be fat. Now get out of the way of the TV. I got money on this game. She says, I think I'm getting fat. I want to go to Weight Watchers. I said, that's great, honey. You go right ahead. I'll still be on this couch when you get back. Then you can help me up. We'll eat more. And she says, but I have no one to go with. I said, well, call your friends. I said, I did, but none of them want to go with me. I said, well, you know what? I said, wait till after the game's over and I'll go with you. She says, you can't go. I go, that's it. Now I'm fucking going. Where's my moo-moo? Now, well, you'd laugh because you don't see a lot of men in muumuus, at least not in the islands. But Dennis Leary was shooting a movie in Hawaii, and he brought me back a muumuu. Yeah, nice friend, right? He says, oh, I did it as an inspiration. He comes back, we're over the house, we're having a couple of beers. He says, I got you a prize from Hawaii. I go, what do you got, coconuts, pineapples? He goes, no, here, it was a muumuu. I was so pissed, I threw him out of my house. And then after about 10 more shots of whiskey, I said, where's that muumuu? Let me try it out. So I put it on. It was all silky and shiny, and I liked it. You know? So I looked at myself in the mirror, and I go, oh, my God, you've lost your mind. And yet, somehow, I still find you attractive. Well, my wife comes in, you're not going anywhere with me with that thing on. I says, all right, where's my sweatpants? Because that's what I wore for 6 years. I mean, when you're that fat, when you're a 56-inch waist, you just can't go buy clothes off the rack. You got to buy the whole rack and stitch them together. And we had a big wedding, and my wife says, you can't wear those to a wedding. It's a very fancy wedding. I said, I'll wear my fancy sweatpants. You know, the nice shiny ones, you know, the Italian guys wear. But anyway, I said, okay. I said, well, I'm taking you to Weight Watchers, whether you want it or not. Now I'm pissed off. So I got a six-pack, and I made a sandwich. We jumped in the car. We drove down to Weight Watchers. Now, none of us spoke while we were in the car because it was one of those married times when you were just pissed off at each other. But you're both going to prove a point. So we go into Weight Watchers, and much to my chagrin, I was the only guy. Yeah, I missed the memo on it being a chick thing. 64 women and me. 64 big women, 64 huge women. And they were all looking at me like they wanted to eat me, and not in a sexual way. So I'm standing there, and they're going, hey, that's Lenny Clark. That's Lenny Clark, the actor. I said, hey, I'm fat. I'm not deaf, you whores. Somebody give me that two-point soup recipe. I mean, I was desperate. I mean, I was thinking of getting that flesh-eating disease, take a little off my stomach, some off my ass, throw it on some skinny guy we all hate. I tried everything. I tried cocaine. I mean, I didn't do cocaine a lot. I mean, I did cocaine once for like 9 years. But I but I only did it so I could learn the metric system. You know? You get the gram, the half gram, the kilogram. That's when you get the real good shit. But people told me if you did cocaine, you couldn't eat. You'd lose weight. So I did cocaine, and I gained fucking weight. It made me eat faster. I tried everything. I went to Subway. That guy Jared, remember Big Bad Jared, went to Subway. I gained 50 pounds. No one told me you couldn't eat the cheese steak subs, that son of a bitch. I'll kick his ass if I bump into him. So I'm at Weight Watchers, and I started losing weight. I lost 70 pounds in 8 months. Then 90 pounds. They go, Lenny, you lost 80. Lenny lost 90. Then I lost 100. They said, fuck Lenny. I said, don't you turn on me, you bitches. I am one of you. It was amazing. I looked down, I could see my feet. I was so happy. Then I could see my knees. Then I could see my man candy. I said, there's my old pal. I'll never let you out of my sight again. We were in L.A. shooting a movie, and someone said, Lenny, would you like to go down to Tijuana? And I said, okay, we'll go down. And we went to Tijuana, and they said to me, would you like to go to a sex show? And I said, hey, that's not really my cup of tea. But I am a patron of the arts, so I'll go. Well, we went to a place that had a donkey show. Now, oh, so some of you people have heard of this. Yeah, I mean, I'm not here to offend you folks. I'm here to educate you and help you. Now, the donkey show was pretty, well, it was appalling. But yet somehow I was intrigued. And this is not to be confused with the donkey show at the American Repertory Theater with brilliant actors and a cost of about $225 a ticket. No, 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 no. This is the donkey show in Tijuana that costs like 60 pesos, which is about 13 American cents. Where a woman comes out and fucks a donkey. Yeah, now I know. Oh, yeah. I, myself, had never seen this. It's also on the internet, which you can see tonight when you go home in the privacy of your own home. But you will be amazed. Because I've never seen a woman have sex with any animal but a donkey. They knew what they were thinking, these Mexicans. Because a donkey dick is an amazing dick. I speak because I'm Irish. I don't have a giant dick. I've got big balls. As a matter of fact, I was the big ball baby when I was born. The nurse thought it was three heads. My mother said, no, that's his balls. Come on, let's go. Wrap him up. But a donkey dick is magnificent. If I had a donkey dick, I could be the ruler of the world. Oh, it's, you know, I could hit you in the balcony from here. I could be in the kitchen making a sandwich, feel like sex, you know, one of those moments on TV you see, and my wife would be in the bedroom. I could go, honey, honey, cut it out, Lenny. Stop it, Lenny, stop it. And she kept it up. I'd trip when she was going to the bathroom. But this was an event beyond all your comprehension, where a woman had sex with the donkey. And after the show, she came up to me, picked me out of the crowd, said, you want to buy me a drink? And I said, no. But I'll get one for your burro. Bartender, anything the mule wants. But that wasn't it. You'd think that would be enough. But oh no, there's more. After that, the mariachi music comes up and the lights dim. And it's really a big, big Mexican guy with yanni hair comes out. And he starts thinking. And he's stark naked. He's just thinking, he's thinking, and he gets an amazing erection. Not as big as the donkey, but it's out there. And then he thinks, and he thinks, and he comes to orgasm and covers the entire first two front rows. Great show, just don't sit up close. Now, look, talk about a Gallagher concert gone bad. Folks, I'm only warning you. But some of you, let's think of the focus this man has. Is there a guy here that could do that?
think himself to an orgasm? Jeez, I can't even jerk off if the neighbors are home. I'm a mess. But if I could do that, I would stop people at a bus corner and go, look at this. A little trick I picked up in Mexico. I'd put down a hat. I'd go, watch this. Bang! Tax that, Obama. Now, what happens? A lot of people don't use the internet for the stuff I do. But I'm not really good at it. I'm not even one of those texters. This is the longest I've been with a group of people that haven't been texting. Don't you think it's getting out of control? I had another tragic texting accident today. When I came around the corner, some guy was texting, and bang, I knocked him right on his ass. And he was in shock as his phone went down the sewer, and he's going, And I stepped over him, I said, I'm so sorry. I text you, but you don't have a phone. But kids today, isn't it nice for you to be out tonight without your kids? Huh? Your little darlings. Isn't it nice just to have a few moments away from those ungrateful little bastards? Always texting. You're trying to talk to them. You want your kids to, oh, can I talk? Yeah, I'm listening, Dad. Put it down. Put it down. If I was doing that, my father would take that thing and ram it up my ass. So go ahead. Text me now. Use your butt cheeks. Go ahead. Text me a message. You little bat. And the kids are so proud. I can text 1,000 words a minute. Hey, we had people who did that 30 years ago. They were called secretaries, you little bastards. Oh, my God. Do you beat your kids? Look at you. Oh, no. Oh. One person. Let me put it this way. Did your parents beat you? Yes, they did. This is why you all turned out better than your... Oh, you think you're better parents than your parents. Oh, I'm better than my parents because I don't beat my kids. Oh, yeah, shit. Your kids are running ripshod over you. They use you. You work 2-3 jobs for those little bastards. Did they ever say thank you or I love you? No. The most you get is a T-N-K-X-U. That's what you get. Not I love you, Mom. I love you, Dad. You get... Hey! Good God. You go home tonight and you wake those kids up and you kick the shit out of them. Beat them. You put a beating on them right now. Do it before it's too late. And you're in a wheelchair and they're burning you with cigarettes and you're going, why? Why? Because you never beat me. You don't love me. Child services, child protective service. You know what that was when I was a kid? That's where they sent you to get patched up for the next beating. You don't beat your kids, not because you're better than your parents. You're afraid they'll call the cops on you. No, you hit me, I'll call the cops. My father would say, what? You better be able to dial the phone with your tongue. Because I'm going to rip your arms off and beat the shit out of you with them. You go to hit your kids, I'll text. You touch me in my secret private area. The cops show up, you're in cuffs. What the fuck are you doing? The kid said, you touch him in the secret private area. I'll kill that little bastard. That's why we got to lock you up. Now, here's what happened. Now, your kids have stepped over the edge. Now they want you to go to their games, huh? Isn't that the big thing? Will you come to my game? Come to your game. How many games did your parents go to? None! Because they were working. They were working for you because they love you and they cared about you. And you knew that they loved you and they cared. You didn't ask them to go to a game, but these little fuckers, they aren't you. Oh, will you come to my game? All right, where is it? Pennsylvania. What? Pennsylvania. Can you believe the balls on these kids? To ask you, the good parents you are, and you don't even get to beat them. No matter how much they hurt you or disappoint you, you can't slap them straight anymore. It's all changed now. And they want you to go to a game. I could see my dad saying, hey, Dad, would you come to my game? What? Would you come to my game? Yeah, that's what I thought you said. Lenny, you killed me. You want me to go to your game? You want me to go to a game? Yeah, that's a great idea, son. Why don't I just quit my job and go to your little game? That's just great. And then after that, we can play another little game of finding a new place to live. How's that, all right? And after that, we can play find something to eat. And while we're doing that, you can text child services because I'm definitely going to kick your ass now. Hey, New York, you people are so great. Thank you, Jenna. I love you. Thank you all. You guys are awesome. Good night.
Thanks, Pat. Lenny Clark, come on, let him know. Lenny Clark. Lenny Clark. Come on.
This is a song about a bunch of people that we fucking hate.
Well, you can't say retard and you can't.
Brand new, the douchebag song. Sure hope you're not in it. It'd suck to be singing along and then discover that you're in it. I really like this song. Oh, fanny packs, fuck. One more time for the Enablers, ladies and gentlemen. Adam Roth on lead guitar. Chris Phillips on rhythm guitar. Come on. On bass, Mr. Alec Morton, ladies and gentlemen. And on the drums, Mr. Charlie Roth. Come on. Teenagers. Next guy gets his own microphone because apparently he's afraid of fucking germs. Please welcome the lovely, the fabulous Adam Ferrara, ladies and gentlemen.
What a dick.
He would have put it in his pants, you know that, right? He would have shoved it right in his pants, but he knows he shouldn't have done that because I'll know it'll smell like his vagina. So that's why he didn't do it. Hello, New York. Nice to be home. How are you? Yes. We've been all across the country. Everyone knows New York's the Big Apple. If you can make it here, you can make it anywhere. But I will tell you something about living in this city and know something about this city. This city goes from historical to shithole in three blocks. Take a walk outside, like,
and the Empire State Building is now the tallest building.
I cut you, bitch! We've gone too far. So thank you guys for coming out and spending your money to come see us in this economy. It's getting better, have you heard? My mom's a little concerned about the economy because she's on that fixed income, and I try and calm her down. I go, Ma, don't worry, you know, the president, Mom, what's the matter with the president? What? Adam, the president is blind. Mom, you don't have to whisper. He knows he's black. Shh. And I feel bad my mom thinks that way, but not bad enough to stop exploiting it for my own amusement. I called her up the other day. I go, Ma, did you hear the news? In order to qualify for health care, we're all going to have to play basketball. Can you box out with your hip? Can you do that? If you pick and roll, you get prescription drugs. Hit the paint, lady. She's in a good mood, though, my mother, because I gave her some good news that I will share with you tonight. I'm getting married. Yes. Thank you, ladies. Yes, it's always the women like, we got one! And you tell the guys, I'm getting married. Jesus. Yeah. I love this woman. I know I love her, right? Do you ever love somebody so much you want to hit him with a shovel? You ever? Have you experienced that bipolar reaction to another human being? When your heart swells and your teeth clench and you think to yourself, this is how I'm gonna fucking die, right here. So I love her, right? I go to buy the ring. And I want to do right by my woman because I know the significance of the wedding ring. Women don't want a ring that's a symbol of the love you have for her or represents the commitment you want to make to her. Women want a ring that pisses off other women. Because they've lived their entire life with this subtext of competition, this girl-on-girl violence they can never speak of because they're civilized creatures. But if they could tell you what they really think, they would say to you, like, this is my best friend, but if life gives her something before I get it, I'll throw the bitch under a bus. So they don't say that, so they communicate through symbols, like bags and shoes and rings and what's new? Fuck you. I'm getting married, you will die alone, surrounded by cats. I love you so much, I'm going to make you my bridesmaid. I'm going to look like a princess and dress you like a Puerto Rican prom queen. So I figured I was pretty smart. I go to buy the ring, and the jeweler asks me a question I'm not prepared for. She says, what size is her hand? Girl size. Wait. Well, it's kind of important because the diamond should sit in proportion to her hand. So just get an idea of the size of her hand. So that night at dinner, I'm looking at her hand, and I'm like, oh, my God. I'm marrying Dan Marino. What?
Look at the mitts on this kid. Jesus.
This is going to cost me a fortune. Is the left one bigger? What the hell is she, a fiddler crab? Great, now we're going to have giant left-handed children.
Daddy, why do I swim in a circle?
So I bought the appropriate ring size for her hand. Ugh, I was so annoyed. I almost proposed to her like this. Here, put this on your flipper, your harbor seal.
I love you.
I love you too. We could have had a Porsche for what this stupid thing cost. You're taking the kids to swimming lessons because I'm not explaining this to them all summer long. So basically, when I do something she likes, I get my little hero praise. She'll tell me like, oh, thank you, baby. Thank you. Thank you so much for not peeing in the sink like an animal. Thank you. Thank you for using the toilet. And I'll just clean this up because you can't be expected to get it all in. Yeah. We actually had this discussion. What is this? What? This? I don't do this. Of course you don't do that, honey. You don't have to aim. You sit down. Gravity's working with you. It's all lined up. I mean, me, you got to allow for the wind. There's a lot of, if you had to aim, you've got any idea what kind of mess this bathroom would be? Look at the way you parallel park. Seriously. She actually said this. She goes, why don't you just dab the end? When you're done, just, you know, dab the... And just take a little piece of toilet paper, tissue, just dip. It's all just dip, just dab the... Just a dab, dab, just a dab, dip. It's not gay.
It's close. Very close. And I don't dab. I shake. Like a man. I'm a shaker. My father was a shaker. His father was a shaker. This is a shaker's home. You are a shaker's wife. We were raised shaker children. Maybe the men in your family. Day. Yeah, believe me, it's not easy to live with me. I'm an idiot. Really, I'm a comic. I'm an insecure egomaniac. You know how big my ego is? I keep a journal and I'm lying in it. Is that alarming to anybody else? I read it the other day. I'm like, I didn't invent the cotton gin. Are you? So, yeah, it's not easy for her to get along with me, man. Like, I yell, and I actually went to see a shrink because I started getting panic attacks. Do you ever get a panic attack? It's a nice way to go through life, isn't it? What a lovely day. Ah! And the only way you get rid of panic attacks is you have to talk about it. Yeah, I'm going to call up my friends. Hey, Dennis, I think I'm getting panic attacks. Really? Do you ever think you're a pussy? Do you ever think of that? I mean, I'm no doctor, but you could be a pussy. It's all I'm telling you. Sounds like acute pussy syndrome to me, sweetheart. Check your urine. Is it pink? Your skin peeling? You got any oily stools in your friggin' underwear? You know what you need to do? Go to Europe, carry a man's bag. That'll straighten you right out, my little friend.
I can see me tell Lenny I'm getting panic attacks. Me too. Life's fucking terrifying. I wish I had more time to tell you more stories. He's out of his fucking mind. I will tell you one thing that I can articulate, one of the reasons I really love this woman. She gives me permission to be positive, which is very important for a guy like me, because I come from people that have a tough time being happy. You know, when happy shows up, you have to be vulnerable to experience the emotion, and you know, like, hey, aren't we having a good time? Yeah, well, shit can happen. Go ahead, dance. That's how Uncle Louie broke his ankle, you stupid ass. Because I was raised here in New York, man. It's either black or it's white. There's no gray. And she's like, no, there's no gray. There's colors. I'm from Northern California, the wine country, and everything's made of soy, and I live under a mushroom. And I asked her father permission to marry his daughter. I did. I said, sir, I've come for your daughter's big hand in marriage. May this union bring peace between the dabbers and the shakers. And he texts back, LOL. So... apparently, I wasn't his first choice. But she got to meet my father. My dad died this year, and she got to spend the last 3 years of his life getting to know him and seeing what a special guy he was and how I loved him so much, and he's still my hero, and she got to know that. So that was very important to me, and I know she loved him, and he loved her. Oh, thank you. Thanks. And I know he loved her because he was telling me in the garage. He said, son, I want to talk to you about your girlfriend here. She's a specialist kid, huh? Yeah. Tell you what, if I was you, I'd cash in. Don't listen to your mother. She's plenty good enough for you. I see the way you look at her. She's got a smile, makes it all better, don't she? Yeah. Trust me, son, you're going to spend the rest of your life trying to love that girl enough. And he was right. I'm a pretty lucky guy. You know when you're out somewhere and you see a beautiful-looking woman and then you look at the guy she's with and you think to yourself, how the hell did that guy get that girl? I am that guy. Thank you very much. Nice to be home.
Adam Bumrara, marrying the girl with the giant hand. Adam Bumrara. Just made that song up. Well, I guess we have to sing this one. I'm just a regular Joe with a regular job. I'm your average white suburbanite slob. I like football and porno and books about war. I got an average house with a nice hardwood floor. My wife and my job, my kids and my car. My feet on my table and a Cuban cigar. Yeah, but sometimes that just ain't enough to keep a man like me interested.
Oh, no.
No way.
Uh-uh.
No, I've got to go out and have fun at someone else's. Dr. Asshole.
Good night, New York. We love you. One more time, Whitney Cummings. Lenny Clark. And Adam Ferrara.
Hey, great show, huh?
Hiya, pal. Good job.
Yeah.
Listen, I gotta ask you. The douchebag song was great. You said douchebag a couple of times, but...
Yeah, it was like the theme of the whole show.
Yeah, but nobody said donuts.
Who's the douchebag now?
What a dick.